Hi, I'm Radzi. Now, when you're researching a news story, the information you get comes from many different sources. Sometimes those sources are people, and when they are, you need to check if they're trustworthy. So think about who they are and why they want to get their voice on the news. Are they only telling one side of the story? What else do you need to do to work out if what they're saying is accurate? In this video, we'll take a look at how BBC journalists exposed a network of hidden detention centres in Western China, where hundreds of thousands of Muslims have been detained without a trial. China denies it's holding Muslims captive and says that people are willingly attending special schools to fight against terrorism and religious extremism. So while you watch the film, have a think about the different primary and secondary sources that are used in the investigation, as well as the advantages and disadvantages of using people as sources for a news story.
In the far west of China, thousands of Muslims are disappearing. Families are being torn apart. Vast, highly secure compounds have been built. And Chinese officials don't want the world to know what's going on inside them.
This was a really difficult story to tell because the Chinese government works so hard to keep it hidden.
China is building a total surveillance state. It's a place where saying, doing, or even thinking the wrong thing can get you locked up in an internment camp.
Journalists working in Xinjiang are monitored and followed everywhere they go. They are often prevented from filming and sometimes even detained. Now, we knew that there were already reports that large numbers of Muslims were disappearing and that giant camps were being built. But because of those difficulties of operating on the ground, we knew that to get to the real truth, we would need to combine our reporting with other sources of evidence. And one of the first things we looked at was the view from above.
Satellite images showed us that many of the places that China said were just schools were in fact vast, highly secure compounds. A team of experts analysed the images of these camps and could tell us more.
Satellites see beyond what the human eye can see. As the years pass, we have detected that the number of infrastructures being built increases, and most significantly in the past 2 years.
The satellite pictures and expert analysis were vital pieces of evidence, of course, but we needed something else, people. Those who could tell us what they had seen with their own eyes and provide us with first-hand testimony that we could then verify against what we already knew.
Because we were constantly watched, though, it was impossible to speak to people in Xinjiang. Even the slightest criticism of the authorities would put them at too much risk. So we had to travel to Turkey, where we met people who had fled from China after being in the camps.
The Chinese government wants us to renounce our beliefs, our ethnicity, and our humanity.
We found people who had been detained in different camps and who were willing to speak out about their experiences inside.
Every day, someone was beaten. There were two men. One had a belt and the other just kicked. If we fell down, they made us kneel again.
It was impossible to know how much of what we were being told was true. But what we could do was to ask as many questions as possible and then to check the answers against each other, to look for overlap and to invite our audiences to consider how consistent the interviews were.
Tell me about life there. What was the routine?
They made us run around the square until sunrise.
In the early morning, we had to run around the square. We had to run for a long time. It was torture.
Some of our sources were too afraid to speak openly, so we deliberately hid their identities.
Journalists have a duty to protect their sources, to make sure that people aren't put in danger because they choose to speak out. There are lots of ways to give people anonymity. In this interview, we filmed this man in silhouette. We used a video effect to blur his face and we've changed his name.
Finally, of course, we needed to go to Xinjiang to try to see the camps for ourselves. As expected, the police tried to stop us, but even that told us something interesting.
If this really is all about education, then why the effort to stop us getting close?
Our reporting made a huge impact. 8 months later, during another reporting trip to Xinjiang, Chinese officials invited us for a highly controlled tour of some of the camps. This was what the government wanted us to see. They offered us this tour as proof that the people in the camps were students, not prisoners. We interviewed staff and inmates, with officials listening in to every word.
Is it your choice to be here?
Yes, I was affected by extremism. I've come here to transform my thoughts.
And we had to balance this with what we'd learned from our own independent reporting.
When you report allegations of wrongdoing or accuse somebody of something, it's important to try to put those claims to them, giving them what we call right of reply.
Doesn't a place where people have to come, obey the rules, stay until you allow them to leave, sound more like a prison? Even if it's a prison in which you can do some art.
I don't know what you mean by prison. This is indeed a training center.
With a story like this, no one single source is enough to hold the Chinese government to account. But by gathering information from multiple sources and verifying them against each other, we were convinced we'd found important new evidence of the huge scale, scope, and true purpose of China's camp system.
As this video showed, there are many different kinds of sources that a journalist can use to report on a story, and journalists need to assess those sources in order to tell the story accurately. So see if you can apply some of this to your next activity.